Now we're going to have the students from the National Campus Leader Summit give their presentation over making the connection between Coach Herman Boone and Holocaust survivor Dean Klein.
Hello, welcome to our Times Talk today about making the connection between Dean Klein and Coach Boone. I am Carly Locke, and you guys just want to introduce yourselves?
I'm James Cadall.
I'm Megan Rust.
Katie Wisely.
And the other person that went to the conference with us, Megan Garcia, could not be here because she is living in Colorado now.
All right, well, in January, the four of us, along with Megan Garcia, Professor Marquez, and Dr. Ian Camp, went to the National Campus Leadership Summit in DC, and it was held at the Holocaust Memorial Museum. This year, the summit was about civic engagement, being involved in one's community, and speaking out for those who cannot speak for themselves. While in DC, we were given a tour of the Holocaust Museum and listened to a survivor tell her story and went on a self-guided tour of the Some Were Neighbors exhibit. We also attended a couple of workshops geared towards civic engagement. The biggest lesson we learned was what it means to be an active bystander in events such as the Holocaust. This year on campus, we've had two phenomenal speakers, Coach Boone and Jean Klein. Both speakers talked about the importance of acceptance and diversity, as well as the dangers of racism and anti-Semitism. As in DC, the importance of speaking up for others was also stressed by the speakers, as well as civic engagement. And again, we were taught what it means to be an active bystander. Being an active bystander refers to the individual choices that people make in a situation where others are being prosecuted or otherwise becoming a victim of injustice. The Some Were Neighbors exhibit told the stories of bystanders during the Holocaust. Some helped victims, some ignored the situation, and others chose to join the Nazis in their persecution of the Jews. This exhibit made it clear to us that doing nothing and ignoring the situation is a choice.
So both of the speakers talked about what does it mean to be an active bystander and why is it so important to them, specifically to deal, kind of connect back to their stories. So Coach Boone had this lovely quote when he gave a presentation, actually the presentation at Fort Hays. Diversity means becoming open to what has been shut for others. So he says to look for situations where diversity is not being upheld and where somebody does not have the voice that they deserve as a human being and as a participant in an activity or something like that. This was really important when he was coaching the football team because it was three huge schools that were not necessarily integrated coming into one school. So the football team was having a lot of issues because there was the problem of there's three schools coming together and all three of them had a football team. And now they have to become one football team, which is already a mess. And then there was a lot of racial tension where they were living because it was in the South, and that is what happened in the South. So he fought really hard to make sure that the team was diverse and inclusive, and he still continues to talk to people about how important it is to make sure that that diversity happens. He really believes that diversity is important because you learn things from other people who have different experiences than you, which I really agree with. And he really wanted us to all focus on embracing the diversity around you rather than being angry that somebody who's different than you is working with you or trying to exclude them because you don't understand where they're coming from. And so he talked a little bit about how he continues to fight for diversity and when there are moments of injustice, how he is an active bystander and how that's so important to him, even now after he's done all of these things, like that's what he still really focuses on doing. And then Jean Klein was talking about, he talked about standing up and being a bystander. One of the things he talked about was the person that helped him when he was in the concentration camp and how it was a small act, but it was really important and it saved his life. That person said, you're a human, you deserve to be able to eat, you deserve health, you deserve what I can give you. And he realized that he couldn't help him escape or things like that, but he did what he could. And he believed that Gene Klein deserved to live, which is really important. It was a really important part of his speech, and I think that's kind of one of the reasons why he's so involved in being an active bystander, because an active bystander saved his life. And sometimes it's not that big of an issue. Sometimes somebody's just saying something that's really insensitive, and you know that maybe somebody's had a life event that has kind of scarred them a little bit, but they're not willing to speak up, and just being like, hey, maybe you shouldn't talk about this because it's kind of hurting the other person that you're talking to. I don't know if you know about it, but maybe you should just calm down. So it can be big and it can be little. One of the really big things that Gene Klein talked about when he had his discussion with us before the meet and greet before the actual event, somebody asked him about the comments that had been made by Sean Spicer about chemical warfare. And what he said really resonated with me, because his father, when they went to Auschwitz, his father was automatically deemed unfit for work and was gassed immediately. And so he talked about the fact that this is chemical warfare, and if you don't want to think about all of the people, or you can't comprehend all of the people, this is one person, and it was my father. And he died because of Zyklon B, which this is a, these are pictures I took at the museum, so this is like an actual artifact from when they liberated the camps. And he talked about how devastating that is, and how if you're not in the situation, you might not understand, but you can't make comments like that when you know that there was something that happened that was so, it was fatal and it was hurtful, and it's something that we never want to happen again. So he went off, he was a little spicy about it, and he said that he believes so much in this country. He fought for this country in the war, and he believes in all the people that are in it, and that we all deserve freedom, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And so he was talking about how he's not going to stop talking about things that are not just. He's not going to stop saying that what people are saying is wrong. He's not going to stop calling people out for ignoring things. And he realizes that people get mad at him, and he's like, well, I'm 85, so you can't stop me, and 89, so you can't stop me, and I'm not going to stop until I can't speak anymore. And he was really vehement about us doing the same thing, and speaking up and not stopping, and not letting somebody ignore what's going on because it's convenient. And so both of these men really, really wanted us to be active bystanders and to make sure that we were involved in what's going on and involved in making the world a better place, instead of just being like, oh, well, you know, I kind of believe that this is something that should be happening in society, but like actually fighting for it. So that, I thought that was really cool. And this is a really great connection to the Embrace Diversity campaign that's going on campus. And Katie will tell you about that.
All right, so you guys hopefully are inspired to become an active bystander because of these two speakers, but you may be wondering how you can do that. So the Embrace Difference campaign was put together by ADP, the American Democracy Project, and the Center for Civic Leadership has actually been a huge part of our project, so thank you to them for helping us out with all of that and getting us organized and everything. But the Embrace Difference campaign was started by Megan Garcia and Alyssa Stepp. They wanted to kind of bring something to campus that would explain diversity and help students become more open to it and open to accepting students of all races, genders, orientations, that kind of thing. So after the summer, like with all the political things going on, they were kind of disappointed in the way that the world was reacting to what was happening. So they started this campaign, and it focuses on LGBTQ, race and ethnic relations, religion, gender equality, and justice. So this is part of like our campaign as well. Like bringing these speakers onto campus to talk about this stuff is like a real life experience between people struggling with diversity and everything. And we might not think that like we have those problems here, but we do. So this campaign like really helps us bring out what we can do on campus. So some of the things that the Embrace Difference campaign has talked about is like microaggressions, being civically engaged, and you know, if you want to get involved, you can go to Times Talks like this, participate in Tiger Talk Back, like the little question that they put up in the union. That'll help you learn what's going on in your community and kind of figure out how you want to take care of that issue. Attend events and start discussions with your classmates, because the only way that you're going to learn more things about diversity and to learn everyone's perspective on that is to actually just talk to people and learn what they're going through. So the Embrace Difference campaign is designed to equip students, faculty, and community members with the desire to understand, have the capacity to for tolerance, embrace difference, and celebrate diversity. So hopefully with all the things that we've been doing the past couple weeks, you guys can take all the lessons that you learned and embrace difference.
All right, so I'm gonna kind of finish this up here, and then we'll have a Q&A section. One thing that I've noticed between both Gene and Herman's presentation is that there's just kind of this air of almost this verbatim quote of, well, that's just the way that things are. And we need to realize that that's not the right way to approach this problem. Let's think about what that says here. Just the way things are implies that you don't have agency in this situation. It implies that things have always been the way that they are. But once again, think about it. When we look at the Jews weren't born with the Star of David on them. They weren't born ostracized from society. That's something that Hitler put on them. Blacks weren't forced, they weren't ostracized at birth. That's something that society put on them. And so we need to approach this problem a little bit differently. We need to say, that's the way things are now. Because that puts our human agency into the question. It says, yeah, those happened, but we're going to change it. One thing that I've also noticed between the two of them is that Herman Moore, Boone, and Gene Klein are both incredibly resilient people. When you look at Herman Boone, he went to school and he coached a team in North Carolina. And that team was 99-8 during his tenure there. And you don't need to know anything about football to know that that is success. The New England Patriots would be incredibly happy with that record. But he was fired. So why was he fired? Well, the school board was incredibly transparent with it. They said, hey, our community's not ready for a black coach. And so he didn't take that. He didn't take that and just go to his easy job. He didn't go and make easy money. He went to one of the hardest places a football coach could go, a school that just integrated. And he went there and he tackled that problem. He united that school. He fought off parents. And then he won championships with that team. Gene Klein survived Auschwitz. That in itself is incredible. And like, when you look at these people, we are so incredibly fortunate to have them here at Fort Hays State, because they're probably two of the more resilient people that we can have on stage and talk to us. So they don't just stop at being resilient either. These are people that speak out. Look at their jobs and look at who they are. Gene Klein, when we were talking in here with them as a group, he said that he wanted to be the mouthpiece. He wanted to be like the president of Holocaust survivors. Self-appointed, of course. And so he flew halfway across the country at age 89 in bad weather to go talk to us. Herman Boone, he goes all around the country. He talks about race relations. He talks about all of these difficult issues. He talks about Martin Luther King. He goes all around the country. He's not a young guy either, I'm sure you guys saw. We need to take these issues that they've talked about and we need to introduce it into our discussion. Us as a staff, student, and faculty group need to bring this to Hays, Kansas, and we need to have these tough conversations, and we need to be civically engaged. And after all, it is Civic Engagement Week, so there's a little plug for that. But so this is really something that we need to approach as a community. When we went to the Holocaust Museum, there was a lot of talk about this poem. It's from Martin Niemöller, and he was a German theologian, but it says, first they came for the socialists, and I did not speak out, because I was not a socialist. Then they came for the trade unionists, and I did not speak out, because I was not a trade unionist. Then they came for the Jews, I did not speak out, because I was not a Jew. But then they came for me, because there was no one left to speak for me. So we need to learn to be these active bystanders. We need to learn to embrace diversity, and we need to learn to have these conversations within our community. At this point, I'd like to open it up if anyone has any questions for the four of us.
I just told you guys to speak up, and I'm a little ashamed.
Well, I can start one with one. What were your biggest takeaways from the summit experience?
I definitely, like, when I had been in school, I hadn't really had an education on the Holocaust. Like, that's crazy, but no one ever taught me what happened in the Holocaust. It's just kind of implied that it happened, and it was a horrible event. But going to the Holocaust Museum really put, like, what happened into perspective, because there's this one display of all the shoes that, like, the Jewish people had lost during the Holocaust. And once you look at those shoes, you kind of realize these belong to actual people. Like, millions of people actually died in this. And it really puts it into perspective, like, how horrible things in history have happened. And it really makes you think more about how that happened, why it happened, and how we can prevent it in the future. Because you never want to see that many shoes of that many people dead, especially when they're, like, children's shoes. And it was just a really, like, sobering experience to see that, definitely.
On a slightly different note, one thing that I took away was just, like, we go to school out in Western Kansas, and we saw all sorts of different schools there. We saw NYU, we saw Yale, we saw Florida State. And so to reach out and talk to students like that, it's a really valuable experience to kind of just share how they go to school and what things that they do daily or life, and also just to get their perspective. And that was really a good takeaway for me.
I think going through the museum and the Some Were Neighbors exhibit, I saw just how many people could have spoken up and not necessarily stopped what was happening, but really slowed it down. And I think one of the things that they definitely made sure that they emphasized during the entire conference was that the United States had the opportunity to take Germany's Jews. Hitler was like, "We don't want them. We don't want them here. Anybody who wants them can take them," and the United States said no. And so I think even if that had been the one thing that they had said yes, it would have made such a big difference. And I think that's what hit me the most, is that so many people decided just to not speak up.
My biggest takeaway was I grew up in a really small town in Kansas, and actually moved from town to town. And I'd never really been involved in a specific community because I've always moved away from it. And so as an adult, I had never looked at the issues or never really paid attention to what was going on. And in fact, I hadn't even planned to vote in this last election. And then I went to this leadership summit, and I was convinced that you need to speak up no matter what, and you need to pay attention to what's going on around you.
All right, so how do you guys think you put that into practice? How do we as students put this idea that we should or we ought to speak up about things that are wrong? It's a lot easier said than done. So what? How do you guys view it as actually putting it into practice?
Well, it starts with conversation, to be honest. All of these ideas just start just by people talking to each other. So watching out for bigotry and things like that, just in normal conversation, and calling out, like, "Hey, man, that's not cool." Like, they're people too. Even something as simple like that can stop something in its roots, and that's really valuable. But I think also having speakers come in and having conversations like this one that we're having right now are also a really good way to engage in this.
I found that I gain a lot of traction by calling people out. When they say something, I'm not nice sometimes. but I'll ask somebody, like, if we're talking about something and there's a really restrictive policy that's really, really unfair to somebody coming from somewhere in the government, and it happens all over the place, I'm like, "So why do you support that, and why do you think, if this was affecting you, would you feel the same way?" And they're usually like, well, I don't know, because people don't really expect people to call them out when they say something that might be super uninformed or really, really just inappropriate for the situation. And I found, I've had some of these situations even in my family. They make fun of me because I'm a feminist, but here we are. And so they'll say something and I'm like, hey, you know, if somebody said that about me, your daughter, what would you do? And sometimes that's not something that people want to hear, but when they have to put it in perspective of their own life, it really makes them stop and think about things. And when they get called out, they get embarrassed, so they stop saying things like that.
It's kind of a follow-up on that. With the embarrassment thing, how do we go about it in a way that doesn't alienate people more and draw more of a divide between us?
I think that you really have to treat it like a discussion rather than like you're attacking someone for their beliefs. So you need to ask them why they believe that, so that they can get down to the root of why that's one of their beliefs and maybe question it and try and like conform that belief maybe to something that's a little bit more friendly to other people and more diverse and everything. So I think that you need to treat it like a discussion rather than just saying, hey, you're wrong. But I don't know, it's always difficult because some people just kind of shut down the conversation. So you have to be very careful with it and just work on your communication skills.
What issues do you see here in Hayes or Western Kansas that might meet the kinds of criteria of discrimination or any of those types of things?
I think a really pertinent one is religion. Whether it's lack thereof or for Muslims or something like that, because we can go back and it was January or February, there was an attack on Somalians in Garden City, essentially just because of their skin color. I think the people just assumed that they were Muslims. So I feel like that's a really pertinent issue. But there's also definitely an LGBTQ element as well. I think that's important.
And with Kansas's laws saying you can be fired without reason, and that just opens the door for discrimination. Since coming out as trans, I've been fired for 4 jobs due to discrimination, and there's nothing I can do about it. That needs to change.
And to change things like that, you guys need to get in contact with your representatives. I know it doesn't seem like it'll help, but honestly, calling them, emailing them, sending them letters, they're going to like look to you for what they should do because you're the people voting for them. And there's apparently something on that table that we'll talk
tomorrow.
About that. Yeah.
Tomorrow so. There's a Times talk on letter writing to your representatives.
It's, in the union, it'll be a table in the union. Take the next step, write your rep. You guys can come, we'll help you. It's not scary.
It's super important to talk to your representatives because they're not going to know what to do if you don't tell them what you want them to do. And they're going to want to be reelected, so they're going to listen to you.
This year, the Embrace Difference programming campaign was a year long. Next year, they're not sure if it'll occur again or how long to have it if it does occur again. So is this something that you will that you hope to see? Or did you like the year-long program? Or do you think it'd be more effective within a month and hit hard on it?
I think that, I mean, it's always important to talk about diversity. If they want to like rebrand it maybe so that people start paying attention to it more as a different like campaign, maybe that would help. But I think that it's always important to talk about those things, so it's never going to be too much or anything like that. So
I've been in classes with people who have said that they, when they were growing up, they never saw anybody outside of their race in their town. And it's not anything that's wrong with anybody, and it's not that it's not a deficiency, but coming to college, a lot of people in these tiny towns in Kansas and Nebraska and Colorado, they just haven't had the opportunity to experience diversity, so they might not necessarily know exactly how to react to such a diverse climate or just understanding other people's points of view because they've just lived in the same town their entire life and it's super homogenous. So I think that having this campaign has been really important because there are a lot of people that want to know. Like they want to know, how can I be more inclusive? How can I work to be a better person in these areas? And I think that the Embrace Difference campaign has been really effective in showing a lot of different ways to do that. So I totally think I should come on.
Oh, I was just going to give an example for his question, but it's okay. So, like what you said about the Muslim community, how they're being attacked. So, this is kind of a personal example. My boyfriend, his name is Christian. He is a Hispanic, and he looks kind of Muslim. Like, people would stereotype him as, like, they might think he's Indian or whatever. And just, he was walking in McMitus a couple weeks ago, and there's a couple in front of him, and they were talking very loudly, and they kept looking back at him and saying, oh, well, how do you feel about Muslims? And then they would whisper and look back at him, and that was just blatant racism just right there. And I just think that it's crazy that that kind of stuff still happens. Like, I don't know, it blows my mind that people can just be that blatantly rude to someone.
Christian's
the nicest
person.
He just didn't say anything. He just kind of took it, and he's like, okay, that's cool, I guess, but yeah, it's kind of scary. Like, I mean, what happens if he's on the street by himself and someone would attack him because they think he's Muslim? It's just, I don't know. I think that's something that's a huge issue right now, especially.
We brought the two speakers to campus, Herman Boone and Jean Klein. Do you know of any individuals on campus or in town who might hold that kind of leadership position, whether they call themselves a leader or just represented positive awareness or positive action in some fashion?
Well, I'm not from Hayes, so I don't have like a whole lot of experience in town.
I would say you all are campus leaders.
Yeah.
So, yeah, us.
I'll have to get back to you.
Maybe I'll just narrow it down. Do you see any leaders other than yourself on campus who are willing to speak up or that you might be able to guide others towards as examples?
I think that a really good example of somebody who has worked really hard to be civically engaged and bring awareness to issues that are important to him that might not be like really apparent to other people is Seth Castle with his book, Why Is Dad So Mad About PTSD? And it's because he couldn't explain his PTSD to his children, and so he found a way to explain it to a lot of people's children. He worked to get a defibrillator installed in Joaquin schools because he has a heart condition, and he knows that if there's not a defibrillator and he has an issue, then he could die, and he knows that can be an issue for other people and that they didn't have that, so he led that campaign. He's working with a few of the leadership 310 groups to record the stories of World War II veterans because he realizes the importance of learning from people who have had that experience and that their stories need to be recorded so that people can learn from them far in the future. And he does, when he really believes in a cause, he goes all in. And I think it's, one of his quotes was, Don't practice what you preach, preach what you practice. And he works really hard to be an example of somebody who's civically engaged.
I think anyone who's involved with the Center for Civic Leadership is going to be kind of a leader on campus and be really aware of those issues because that's why they're going to be involved with those activities that they put on. So anyone who like works in the Center for Civic Leadership or is at a lot of their events, definitely. Maybe not Connor. <I'm> fine.
I don't remember his name, but there's a professor in the biology department. I've had three friends go through his classes, and he apparently has a lecture where he kind of takes down racism using DNA evidence. So that's a good impact on the community. And since it's an intro to biology class, a lot of people have to go through it, so that's a big impact on the community, I think.
And pretty much all my teachers that I've had here in Hayes so far, I've only been here for a year, have been avid speakers in classrooms about civic engagement, about being involved. So I think that makes a big impact on a lot of students.
I think it's really hard to go to the school and not be civically engaged.
It's a really important thing on campus.
Yeah.
Can I ask what your biggest takeaway was from Coach Herman Boone?
Resilience.
I think he just he kept standing up for what he knew was right, and he was like, I know that this is right, and he just kept doing it. He didn't stop. He was like a bulldozer, and just like, naysayers, away. And I think that I really aspire to become somebody like that and have that strong of convictions.
Mine is kind of just a comment going back to Whitney's question, is building off of what you guys said, was the resilience and the, I'm going to rephrase what you said, Megan, letting the haters hate. And that I think it was like the way he composed himself while doing it, the grace that he showed throughout the entire process is something that we can all learn from. It was stoic in a way where just takes what happens to him and it doesn't change the way he goes about doing what he's doing.
Anyone else? All right.
No.
Awesome. Okay. Thank you so much for coming, and just remember to keep working hard to make this a great place to go to school for everybody.